So, let's continue in numerical methods. So we derived a nice formula or intuition for the optimal shift size in the finite difference approximation, looking at the forward finite differences. So we got the result that the optimal shift size is approximately square root of 8 times C0, the scale of the function evaluation, divided by C2, the scale of the second derivative, multiplied with epsilon. So it's somewhere around a constant times square root of epsilon, so a constant times 10 to the minus 8, and the constant depends on the ratio of the value and the second derivative. Now let's do the same for the centered finite difference. So we will just repeat the steps. So if we consider now the central finite difference approximation, so I have an upshift and a downshift. So I have again a part that is coming from the Taylor expansion. But now for the Taylor expansion, we have that the bound is some constant C3. The constant C3 is related to the third derivative. So a bound on the third derivative, C3 divided by h squared divided by 6. Okay, so that is the part that is coming from the Taylor. So from the Taylor expansion, so we have some order of h squared here, choose h small. The other two estimates are fairly the same. So we have the difference between the finite difference approximation. Oops. Using the true mathematical expression for the finite difference approximation. So that is here the centered finite difference approximation. And then the computer arithmetic operations that are required to calculate this. So we have first the rounding error in the function evaluation itself. So this gives me here in the same way the alpha. And then I have the rounding error coming from the rounding of the finite difference. This gives me here again another epsilon C0. Everything is divided now by 2h. So the only difference is here that I have a 2h here. And then I can combine these guys. To get a single estimate consisting of these two parts, the parts coming from the floating point arithmetic, which would prefer larger values of h, and the part coming from the Taylor expansion, which would prefer smaller values of h. So only difference is here this constant 1/6 from the Taylor, the square here from the Taylor, and the 2h. So now again, let's try to minimize this value. So this means I differentiate the bound. So for the part coming from the floating point arithmetic, differentiated, the 1 divided by h becomes a minus 1 divided by h squared. And for the part coming from the Taylor expansion, the 1 divided by 6 c3 h squared becomes a 2 times 1 bit divided by 6, so 1 bit divided by 3 c3 times h. So minimizing this means set it to 0. Okay, so I just move this part here now to the other side. So then I multiply with h squared. I get a 1 divided by 3 c3h to the power of 3 is equal to alpha plus epsilon c0. I just divide by the c3 divided by 3. So I get a 3 times divided by 3 in front. And then I take the root. Yeah, so my optimal shift size is now the third root of 3 times, and then a very similar expression, alpha plus epsilon c0 divided by c3. And again, if we think that the function evaluation, which could be worse, yeah, could be a Monte Carlo or whatever, but is in the best possible case where we can expect that it is just epsilon times the magnitude of the function, then I can replace the alpha with epsilon c0, and I get a very nice one. I just get 6 times z0 divided by 3, c3, epsilon, and from that to the power of 1/3. What's that? There's an issue here. I'm sorry. No, now it works. Okay, so maybe there's room here to write the conclusion for our example. So how did I do that? It was blue and green. Okay, so now we have a nice guess, yeah, or a nice suggestion for an optimal shift size for the centered finite difference. So again, note here for floating point double, I have that epsilon is 10 to the minus 16. So this means the third root of epsilon is approximately some 10 to the minus 5. So 5.3, if you like. Okay, so I can choose the shift a little bit larger. I can choose the shift here around a 10 to the minus 5, 5.3 something. For our example, I have that the third derivative is of the same order of magnitude as the function itself, because the third derivative is also the exponential function. So I have that z0 is approximately or is equal to 3.3. So I have that my my optimal shift size for, say, the exponential function x at x equals 0 is approximately third root of 6 times 10 to the minus 16. Okay, so this is approximately, forget about the 6, yeah, this is something like a 10 to the minus 5.3 something. Or maybe you take a 4 here, I don't care. Okay, so let's immediately switch to our example and check this in the code, and have a look at this. So I just copy here the method that calculates the forward finite difference, and I just modify it to a method that calculates the centered finite difference. So instead of upshift and value, I just calculate now upshift, downshift. So let's call this here dn for x minus shift. So that's the downshift. And the finite difference approximation is upshift minus downshift divided by 2 times shift size. So I need to divide again by 2 here. Okay. And let's have here a centered finite difference approximation error printed. Okay, and let's try maybe also this guy. So have here another printout. So now I print here the value for the centered one, and let's print a few guys. So let's print the centered one for the 10 to the minus 8, and maybe also the 10 to the minus 12, and then 5 maybe, and a 3, a 3, and so on. And let's check how this looks like. Okay, so and you see that for the 10 to the minus 8, well, actually, I get a very similar result as for the forward finite difference. So you wouldn't even see that it's good to choose centered one. Okay, so if you just say, okay, centered one has a better approximation, let's choose 10 to the minus 8 and use the centered one. Actually, it's not better. Yeah? It's just almost the same error, because all the error is coming from the noise in the floating point arithmetic. But now, since the error on the from the Taylor expansion is smaller, I can use a larger shift size. So indeed, you can go to 10 to the minus 5 and have a big improvement. Okay, and you see that if you make the shift size then larger as 10 to the minus 5, you have that the second order term is kicking in and you get more errors coming from the second order term. So indeed, we have verified a little bit numerically the result that somewhere here, the best shift size is located. Maybe I can also check something in between, say say 5 times the 10 to the minus 4, so something in between. Okay, so that's already worse. Oh, 5 times 10 to the minus 5 would be in between. So maybe we can check something in between, like a 5 times 10 to the minus 5. Okay, but that's already bad. Okay, so maybe let's leave it. Maybe we can also do the plot for the centered finite difference. So here I'm plotting the forward finite difference. So let's duplicate our little plot method. So that here is our plot method. So I call this now plot centered finite difference. So inside again, I calculate now upshift, I calculate downshift. And the finite difference is upshift minus downshift divided by 2 times the shift size. Okay, so that should be the right plot. And maybe the title has to be corrected. So this is the centered finite difference. And that should be the right plot. So let's plot this guy between 10 and minus 6. So, if you just remember the forward finite difference between 10 and minus 6 looked like that. So indeed, something around a 10 to the minus 8, there was a good spot here. Now, if we move to centered finite difference, so that's the centered one, you see that the higher order error is gone. One-sided centered. Yeah. The noise on the left-hand side is very similar. It's not the same, yeah, because you have two different rounding errors. Okay, so we can go more to the right. Let's go more to the right. We think that the good approximation is around 10 to the minus 5. So let's go from 8 maybe to 4 for the centered one. Okay, and we get this picture here, and indeed, maybe it's here at 10 to the minus 5.4. Yeah, so somewhere around here, I would think is the optimal shift size. So let's conclude and summarize a little bit the result. So here is everything in a little lemma for the centered and for the one-sided finite difference. So if we have some estimates on the value of the function, so this is just the order of magnitude of the function evaluation, and we have these estimates also for the second derivative with a different constant C2 and for the third derivative with a different function constant C3. And if we have here the alpha that gives us the rounding error in the function evaluation, yeah, so could be the best possible case, just epsilon C0, but here the result is general. Then we get these estimates. So with respect to the alpha, you see that if, for example, V tilde is some numerical algorithm that has a much higher error, then the best possible case, your floating point precision, for example, it's a Monte Carlo approximation that has an additional Monte Carlo error, then you see that here the alpha occurs here, and you would like to make H maybe much larger than these values. Okay, so you have to keep this in mind if you go later to calculate finite difference approximations from numerical algorithms that already have a numerical error. So that's really an important thing. Yeah, so and you saw that here 10 to the minus 5 is already the value that we should use for centered finite difference if this error alpha is the best possible case. So, and 10 to the minus 5 is not such a very small number. Yeah. So, okay. Yeah, so these are the estimates we derived. And okay, so this is a little bit an interpretation. So if the second derivative is, for example, much larger than the value, then we should favor small shifts. So maybe I write again here. Is the place here? Okay. Yeah, so maybe let's have a small interpretation and discuss a little bit these optimal shift sizes and the role of these constants. So maybe I do that here because here I have a bit more space. So the two expressions which we derived were 8 times C0 divided by C2 times epsilon, and from that the square root for the one-sided finite difference. So this is square root of 8 times C0 divided by C2 square root times epsilon square root. So we see there occurs here a C0 divided by C2, and from that a square root. And for the centered I had a third root, I believe it was 6 C0 divided by C3 times epsilon. So was it a 6? I believe, yes. Yeah. Okay, so that is 6 to the power of 1/3, and then we had here a C0 divided by C3 to the power of 1/3, and then I had an epsilon 1 divided by power of 3. So I had here another constant in front. I had here C0 divided by C3 to the power of 1/3. Okay, and what are these constants? Okay. So recall a little bit the Taylor expansion which we had. So then you see that the arguments, so here the x and the x plus h, they live maybe on a different scale as the function evaluation v. So we had this for our exponential example in this nice little picture, yeah, that we had small values of h, and the function evaluation was at a different scale. It was around 1, so normal or larger values. And the accuracy epsilon is actually living on the scale of the function evaluation. So we had epsilon times C0. So, and now I would like to know what is the accuracy I should consider on the argument scale. So this is the scale of H, and the result scale, so the evaluation scale. So this is the scale of V. And you see, if you look here at the second derivative, then a change in h is multiplied with the second derivative to result in a change in v. So this means if I would like to look at changes, so accuracy, of order C0 epsilon in the V space, then I should consider that there is a multiplication with the second derivative. So this is a C2 that translates this to the scale, and here it's actually the square root of the scale, to the scale of H. So these constants here are completely reasonable. So if you think, for example, that you have physical units, yeah, for example, this here is meter, and this x, the argument is second. Yeah. So then the accuracy epsilon that you are looking for is on the meter unit, but epsilon is a relative accuracy. Yeah. So it is how many meters per meters. Yeah. So it is a relative one. So you see this here. Okay. It is a relative error. So this is in meters, this is in meters. So this is unitless. So if this one lives on the scale of meters and or on the units of meters and the arguments are the seconds, then H is a change in seconds. So this here is second squared. So the second derivative is how many meters per second squared? Yeah, so it's an acceleration. So what is this constant here? So this constant is meters divided by meters per second squared. So this is a second squared, one divided by second squared. So this here is a second squared. Then this is a square root, gives me a second. So this here is the unit conversion to the space of the arguments. Yeah. So it's seconds. So this is the relative error on the scale of meters. And this here is the unit conversion to the space of the seconds. Or again, for the centered finite difference, I have here the third derivative. I have here the error term that comes from an h to the power of 3. So you see the third derivative here is a meter per seconds to the power of 3. So the velocity of the acceleration, the change of the acceleration. So it is meters per seconds to the power of 3. So I changed the unitless relative error with a constant that is meter divided by meters per second to the power of 3, which is seconds to the power of 3, third root to the seconds. Okay, so these constants here have a certain meaning, and they reflect the behavior of the function. Yeah? So how big is the impact of a change of the argument? How big is the impact of a change of the argument on the value of the function? Yeah? And that is either driven here by the third derivative or by the second derivative. And of course, this is important in choosing the optimal shift size. Okay, so that was my session on the optimal shift size for the finite differences. And maybe you saw that it's a very nice aspect here that you have to really combine the knowledge about computer arithmetic and this, well, a little bit trivial stuff that you can derive approximation formulas from Taylor expansions. So here are also in the script the graphs, which I've plotted together with you in the code. So this here is the, this here is the one-sided finite difference on the left column. And this here is the centered finite difference on the right column. And on top is the range from, say, minus 20 to, I don't know what's that, maybe minus 1. So a slightly broader range. And here I'm somewhat zooming in. So to a minus 10 to a minus 6, yeah? And you see from the picture on the top, it's not so clear where to choose the optimal point, yeah? But here it's maybe clear, and we would maybe choose the optimal point or the optimal shift size around a 10 to the minus 8. And the same thing for the center finite difference. So there I can use a little bit larger shift size. They go to a minus 7 here and go to a minus 4 here. So if I zoom in here, I get the picture below, and the optimal shift size is somewhere around the 10 to the minus 5 here. Okay, so that was it for today. Yeah, you can check the code for this numerical experiment and this session in our Git repository. So the code is here. And maybe you can play a little bit with this using different finite difference approximations or different functions and verify a little bit the result. So thank you. That was it for today.